Sports sedan and touring car trophy race to be contested over two heats. This is the first. Both heats over 10 laps of the 2.25 mile circuit, total distance of 22.5 miles, or in metric terms 36 kilometres. Pole position on the grid taken by Frank Gardner, driving from England in the Chev Camaro. He shares it with Ian Geoghegan in the Falcon GDHO. On the second line, Allan Moffat, car number 9, the Trans Am Mustang, and on the second line with him, Johnny Harvey, driving the Torana V8. On the third line, Bob Stevens, another Trans Am Mustang, and Brian Sampson of Victoria in a Toyota in car 78. Fourth line, Brian Thompson of Victoria in a Torana, and with him is John Goss in a Porsche. Almost ready to start heat one of the sports sedan and touring car trophy race.
There you can see just how slippery the road is at Warwick Farm tonight, and storming through on the inside goes Allan Moffat past Frank Gardner, who made a fairly cautious or either perhaps an over-exuberant start, but and there slipping off on the outside with his hand raised is John Goss. Something of a disappointment for all those Goss fans. The camera now on Bruce Carey with his Capri V8 and the rest of the field storming round through this water-laden homestead and out into Homestead on the and into Hume Strait at the start of the first lap.
Incredible start by Allan Moffat, coming away from the inside of the second line to go straight to the lead. How he got around Gardner, I don't know, but look at the lead he's opened up as he goes around Polo Corner for the first time. And there's Gardner back in fourth place. Frank Gardner qualifying with the fastest time to take pole position, 1:53.2. Moffat was 8 tenths of a second outside that time. He went round in 1:54 in yesterday's official practice session. Between these two artificial lakes here at Warwick Farm, and Moffat has opened up a substantial lead at the stage, yet to complete the first lap. First lap, this is Polo Corner. He's our ledger corner at least, into the home straight and over the finishing line. That's the end of the first of 10 laps. And let's have a look at this lead that Moffat has as he goes around Paddock Bend into the crossing and then up Hume Straight. Straightening up the Hume Straight now, and you can see the margin between first and second. Into Hume Straight. This is a long tearaway straight. Coming up towards Creek Corner now, you'll see him have to brake quite sharply to go around this very tight hairpin bend at Creek Corner. So Moffat clearly has the first place on up. Now the battle for second place between car 76, which is Johnny Harvey in the Torana, and car number one, the Falcon GDHO, driven by Ian Geoghegan.
Here we've got two of the classic sports sedans in Australia at the moment. John Harvey, bright red Torana, built up by Bob Jones and powered by one of Bob Jones' former sports car racing engines, 4.5 litre single overhead camshaft Repco V8. And there, glued behind him in the typical impassive fat man style, is Pete Geoghegan, worrying young John Harvey. And then possibly onto the causeway here, we'll see Geoghegan get magnificently sideways again. He's a prodigal driver, is Pete Geoghegan. Never happier than when the odds are against him.
So the order at the moment is Moffat leading from Harvey and Geoghegan, and Frank Gardner in fourth place. But these are the second and third cars here. Harvey in the Torana, and past him on the inside is Geoghegan and the Falcon to take over second place. And now we could see quite a dice for the lead at this race. Allan Moffat in the Trans Am Mustang, and now Geoghegan setting out after him in the Falcon GDHO.
Alan, you can see that Geoghegan got his way through there at Polo, really by worrying John Harvey for the best part of two laps, and Harvey, I would feel, with this nippy little Torana, is not completely at home at the farm. Now we've got Frank Gardner sitting behind him, and Frank, a wily old stager, is probably going to try much the same technique.
So this is Moffat as he comes up, Geoghegan at least, the second placer, is giving him time, and he's still some 100 yards behind the leader, Moffat. Number one, the Falcon GDHO, Ian Geoghegan at the wheel.
Absolutely gratuitously, Geoghegan starting to flash his lights. Now, since the days of Norm Beachy, this was an I'm coming through sign. Although Moffat's 100 yards ahead, and once again, the psychological war against Allan Moffat is being waged.
So that's the leader, Allan Moffat, coming across the causeway. Now, we'll get an idea of just how far his lead has been reduced this time. Moffat still in front in the Mustang. Geoghegan out after him all the time. Around Polo Corner. Towards Ledger Corner, and he'll straighten up to complete the third lap. So Moffat through, completing the third lap. Geoghegan behind him in second place, to be followed by Johnny Harvey, who's still holding down third, just in front of Frank Gardner. In fifth place is Brian Sampson of Victoria in the Toyota, followed by Brian Thompson of Victoria in the Torana. So they're the first six placings after 3.5 laps. So Moffat around Creek Corner once again. Geoghegan still in second place. And still the battle remains between Harvey and Gardner for the third position. Johnny Harvey losing a little bit of ground. He must have spun off the track down the back. And he's on the track though, but it's given third place to Frank Gardner. That's the distance between these two, Moffat being pursued by Geoghegan. Between Moffat and Geoghegan, but they've opened up a considerable break to the next car, and that's the Chev Camaro driven by Frank Gardner, car number two. But these two have the race all to themselves, with only a couple of laps remaining in this first heat of the sports sedan and touring car race. Very tight line on the inside taken by Moffat, but drifted off the first. Crossing, Frank Gardner still in third place, and you can see the other cars nowhere to be seen in front of him, so as Graham Howard suggested, Gardner not doing anything other than trying to maintain his third position and hope for that good position at the start of the next heat. Still battling it out under Shell Bridge, down towards the crossing, and we'll see them go across the lakes again shortly.
Well, this has been a very convincing demonstration by Allan Moffat. Part opportunism where he seized a very useful lead at the start when Frank Gardner rather bombed his start. But from then on, he seems to me not to have put a foot wrong. This is Moffat, the driving machine. A man who out of the cockpit is quietly warm, but once behind the wheel tends to be made of tool steel, I think. And there's nothing much that Pete Geoghegan, driving like a demon, seems to be able to do to reel him in.
Lap 5 by Geoghegan, 151.5, a very fast time indeed. Fastest qualifying time in practice, 153.2, but as we saw earlier, as he tried to catch up to Moffat, he recorded a good lap, 151.5.
Possibly the one remaining opportunity now for the positions to be reversed, or for that matter for Geoghegan to close the gap, is for Moffat to be held up by slower cars, which they'll be lapping as the race reaches its final stages. And they've got several slow cars ahead of them now as they head towards the S's. This could possibly happen, but on the other hand, Moffat is no fool. I think he's probably planning well ahead to be in the right part of the road at the right time.
Towards the end of the race, no more than a lap and a half to go. It's still Moffat holding his lead in front of Geoghegan, and has this hazard of having to pass the cars that are being lapped, and has to do so by not giving Geoghegan the opportunity of getting past him at the same time.
To this race. Okay, closer now than he's ever been. Finishing flag closer than it's ever been for these drivers. Geoghegan attempting to power past as they run up to the start-finish line and not quite making it, but Moffat now can be in no doubt at all that Geoghegan's right there behind him waiting to pounce.
And two very fast lap times having been recorded on lap 6, both of them. Allan Moffat 149.4 and only 3/10 of a second outside him. Geoghegan 149.7. Those times recorded on lap 6. Effort by Geoghegan. Around the creek corner for what should be the last time in this heat. Moffat still holding that lead. Geoghegan in second place, Gardner third.
Moffat now well and truly held up behind Doug MacArthur in the Falcon V8. Geoghegan had to button right off to avoid running into the back of Moffat, as a matter of fact, for an instant there. And you can see the level at which this race is now being run. Braking is very heavy indeed on what's obviously a sodden road. Acceleration is being wound out to the maximum consistent with the adhesion, which is about 0.1. Both drivers, I would imagine, are going to finish this race wet through and not from rain.
Over the crossing, the order is Allan Moffat in the Trans Am Mustang, Ian Geoghegan, the Falcon GTHO in second place, Frank Gardner, the Chef Camaro, third, car six, Bob Stevens in the Trans Am Mustang in car four, in car six is fourth, and fifth place being held down by Brian Thompson in the Torana. That's the way they should finish at the end of this first heat. Second, and Frank Gardner will be third. So grid positions for the second heat having been determined by the result of the first. Moffat and Geoghegan on the front line, Gardner and Stevens on the second row of the grid, Thompson and Harvey on the third line, and Brian Sampson and Bruce Carey on the fourth line of the grid. Any second now.
Horsepower onto a slippery road, and Frank Gardner, despite the tyre trouble which lost him from pole position, and right lost in the middle of all that is Bruce Carey, biffed in fact missed by almost everybody. Once again John Goss going gardening in the Porsche right after the start,
And with all that drama in front of our very eyes, the leaders rushing away sideways, out from the homestead, and launching themselves down here straight for another 10 laps.
And it didn't take long for these three leaders to sort themselves out. Moffat, Geoghegan and Gardner, they're the three who got the best of the start. Geoghegan got a bit of wheel spin trying to match the start with Moffat. He wasn't able to do it, but he settled into second place, and that's Gardner going around in third place.
Behind him, Bob Stevens with John Harvey, right behind him in the Repco Torana, and behind him, the very interesting Repco-powered Torana from Victoria with independent rear suspension and driven by Brian Thompson. The field now storming through, and there on camera is that little Toyota Celica, driven very successfully by Brian Sampson. Little 1600cc car which is going particularly well in amongst the big iron of the V8s. Moffat low flying with the tail high, pinning it down as he comes into the multiple left-hand corners of the causeway, starting to open out a little lead over Geoghegan in the lightweight 600 horsepower Falcon. And the Celica is still very nicely placed in about sixth position. All the good Japanese factory mods on this little car. A very accomplished driver of small cars, Brian Sampson, at the wheel. Here's motor racing with an American accent. Punching past the pits at the end of the first lap in the big red Mustang. The road's still very slippery. In fact, the circuit, while dry briefly before this race, has been wetted again as the road started to come down. Lead that he's held since the fall of the flag. Behind him, Geoghegan. These two starting to pull away from the rest of the field. Additional rivals. Trying to find a third place man. Ready at this stage. The two leading cars have pulled well away from Frank Gardner, who was in third place.
So it appears that Frank Gardner spun out and is off the track and needs assistance, which means he'll now have to pull out of this race, having that accident early on in the second lap, which leaves Moffat in the lead ahead of Geoghegan, and soon we'll find out the other placings for you. Bob Stevens has moved up to third place in the Trans Am Mustang, so the two Mustangs are running first and third. Car 76, the Torana of Johnny Harvey's, is fourth, followed by Ryan Thompson, and another Torana is fifth. So an interesting race. Frank Gardner having pulled out, but Moffat going straight to the lead and again holds his great lead over Ian Geoghegan.
First two cars through, followed by a long stretch of wet and empty roads. Bob Stevens, Marlin Mustang. Behind him on the stage is one of the Toranas we can. We'll see, see which one it is. In the Melbourne entered bright red Repco engine Torana. And there's our second and third place cars splashing their way towards the homestead. Behind them is Brian Thompson in his independent rear suspension Torana. And Bob Stevens at last starting to get this Mustang cracking under care of Barry Sharp. Battering his way at about 125 odd miles an hour under Dunlop Bridge at the foot of the straight, and Harvey in the somewhat more sophisticated Torana, drawing right level with his rear bumper as they edge their way around creek and gingerly apply the power on the wet road. John Goss, meantime, back into the pits after not a very successful day's racing. Off the road within 100 yards on the first start, started both occasions, then back into the race, but not particularly likely that he'll finish the places.
Shortly to complete their third lap, and you can see some lovely interior shots there of Moffat working overtime to correct as he went round those corners over the crossing. A very capable driver indeed under all conditions. And probably one of the greatest drivers of production cars we've seen in Australia in many years. Moffat still leading from Geoghegan. His lead would be quite a good one after only three laps. Third place, Bob Stevens, still holding down that position just in front of Johnny Harvey. So we have the Trans Am Mustang running first, the Falcon second, another Trans Am Mustang third, and a Torana V8 of Johnny Harvey in fourth place.
Ahead of the race, turning once again to fairly familiar Moffat-style precision. Useful lead at the stage of about 3 to 4 seconds over lead Geoghegan in the bright yellow and very sideways Falcon. Stepping carefully up through the S's here. Looking more like speedboats than sedan cars at this stage. Great stylists of Australian motor racing in the 1960s and 1970s. One of the largest men in Australian motor racing as well, Pete Geoghegan. Probably a loss to open wheel racing because they allege that he can't fit in one, but in the roomier cockpit of a big car like this, he's very much at home. Nothing frightens him. He's got tremendous balance, tremendous competitive edge. He's driving a motor car now which has more horsepower than the cars running in the Tasman race and considerably less road holding. And driving with that typical Geoghegan abandon. He doesn't particularly mind if he gets sideways because there's never been a slide that Pete Geoghegan couldn't sort out yet.
Frank Gardner, who ran third in the first heat, not looking particularly happy with himself, with his car having been pulled out of the race in the first lap. Car 27, the Morris Mini S, driven by Laurie Hazelton, lapped very easily indeed by Moffat. Just over four laps to go and having all the track at his disposal. Track in most parts appearing a lot drier than it was for the running of the first heat, but where they are now, going into Hume Straight, is perhaps the wettest part of the track.
We're now starting to reel in one of the slower cars. No trouble at all to pass him down the straight. And there's Samson back in the picture again. This quite distinctive coloured car, pale salmon pink and white. Very neatly turned out, with the factory flared guards and streamlined headlights. Make quite an impressive motor racing sort of noise, good sharp crisp four-cylinder noise. And Samson, of course, most accomplished driver, nice delicate touch. Never looked in any trouble at all in the rain. Car in New South Wales. In fact, it's probably one of the very first appearances the car has made anywhere in Australia. These cars have been raced with some success around the Far East with backing from a Japanese factory. There's a Philippine-based team of these cars which is so powerful looking that you almost feel you're taking your life in your hands to step in front of them. They are really nasty looking racing cars and they go very hard indeed.
Just over three laps to go, Geoghegan still in second place, but he's a long way behind the leader, Moffat. Holding down third place is Johnny Harvey, as Geoghegan coming around Ledger Corner very nearly went over the edge, and had he done so, he could well have stayed there because those edges are very soft indeed. The Torana V8 of Johnny Harvey holding down third place in front of Bob Stevens, and in fifth place, Brian Sampson of Victoria in the Toyota. Toyota at least, going faster than very quickly, the Torana of Johnny Harvey.
creek. There's Moffat coming up behind one of the traditional Australian racing cars, an immaculately turned out Holden. Now coming up behind Tom Nailard's home-built V8 Torana, which very nearly sandwiched Moffat against the Armco, and then just as quickly pulled back. Moffat with three slower cars at least between him and his pursuer, Pete Geoghegan, able to run the race now. Slightly less pressure, but still going particularly hard, particularly in view of the conditions. Australian motor racing. This is the car that Moffat has had for nearly 4 years, attempting to win the Australian Touring Car Championship with. Never quite did it. One year or another, it was Norm Beachy or Bob Joan that somehow got in the way. And Moffat, despite on occasions absolutely convincing displays of superiority, never quite managed to put together enough points to win the title. And now that that style of touring car racing has been regulated out of existence, the motor car now becomes a sports sedan and looks as though it's going to seal up sports sedan racing.
Moffat getting well up towards the 150 mile an hour mark up Hume Straight. Perhaps not quite that fast, but really driving it hard.
Here you can see really a rather incongruous sort of racing car when you come to look at it dispassionately. This is a motor car supposed to be able to carry four people in reasonable comfort and travel on the road. In fact, it represents about $30,000 worth of sheer cash in bits and pieces. It has some 600 horsepower under the bonnet, wheels which cost about $250 each, tyres which cost $150 to $200 each. The engine needs overhauling about every 500 miles. The gearbox is fairly difficult. The whole motor car has none of the American pony car about it anymore. This is a full-fledged and rather nasty thoroughbred for one purpose only, which is racing. You can see Moffat all the time working in there, trying to stay at least one step ahead of the beast before it snaps around and bites him.
Moffat coming up now to complete his second last lap. He won the first heat convincingly, and he's well on his way to doing the same in the second heat and win this race almost unchallenged.
That's what we expected from Frank Gardner. It's failed to materialise in either half of this race. Gardner finding that the rather vintage wet weather racing rubber which he had, and which was quite adequate under the slightly colder conditions of practice day, in fact started to deteriorate quite markedly and quite badly in today's warmer conditions, and he felt that within three laps of the start of the race, the first half of the race in fact, he could see his chances washed down the drain. And as we saw the beginning of this race, this half of the race, Gardner had parked his car some 100 yards off the road sideways in the long grass, a fair indication of just what had happened to the road holding of his tyres.
Allan Moffat with more than half the circuit on this final lap covered. He'll come around the causeway between these two lakes. Right-hand bends and two short straights, and Allan Moffat will take the flag to win the sports sedan and touring car race. Ian Geoghegan in second place in the Falcon GDHO, but it's going to be another easy win for Allan Moffat of Victoria, the Trans Am Mustang, winning both heats convincingly to take the race with quite a degree of precision. This is the margin now to the Second runner will be Ian Geoghegan in the Falcon GDHO. And third place should be Johnny Harvey in the Torana V8. But Harvey, a long way back, he's certainly been outpowered by these two very big engines indeed, although this Torana is fitted with a V8 engine itself. Johnny Harvey, who had his start in speedway racing in New South Wales, now representing the very strong team for which he drives, established in Victoria. Moffat taking the race with two firsts in both heats. Ian Geoghegan had 2 seconds to finish in second place, and third place shared between Johnny Harvey, who had a fifth and a third, and Bob Stevens, who had 2 fourths. The time for Moffat in the second heat was 18 minutes 9.1 seconds. Thank you.